witnesses this morning.
I grabbed mine and set it down there so I would have it later. Hey, how are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Coming between you two.
Hey, David, we met, but it's been a while. It's been nice to see you.
It's my birthday.
So, very hard to top those first three sessions. It's really been a great morning. But we're going to do it, I think. We have with us Professor David Barstow. He's the Reaver and David Logan Distinguished Chair in Investigative Journalism at the University of California, Berkeley Graduate School of Journalism. And he's going to do a little bit of a luncheon keynote to talk about the state of investigative reporting nationally in Georgia. And then we'll come back with this other outstanding panel of investigative journalists. And I'm going to try to put them all on the hot seat a little bit about investigative journalism. Before joining the ranks of academia, David was an investigative journalist himself, working at the Rochester Times Union, the Green Bay Press Gazette, and the St. Petersburg Times. So he got his start really in local journalism. He joined the New York Times in 1999, starting by covering the 2000 presidential election. During his decade there, he won an unprecedented 4 Pulitzer Prizes, either individually or with part of teams. That's the first reporter in the history of the Pulitzers to win 4. That's pretty amazing. Among David's big stories, a probe into how Donald Trump and his family avoided paying $500 million in taxes, an investigation into workplace safety for the New York Times and for Frontline, and one that hit home for me personally at the time, he exposed how the Pentagon had quietly co-opted retired generals to spin for the war effort, even as they worked as on-air analysts for news organizations, including my old one at CNN. So we're going to hear from David for a bit. Then we're going to have that conversation about investigative journalism nationally in Georgia. I'll introduce the other panelists after we hear from David. And for those of you who are student journalists, I want to call your attention to this. There's an opportunity to meet with David, talk to him individually and in a group after the session in the President's boardroom. So please, if you're a student journalist and thinking about a long-term career, particularly in investigative journalism, don't miss out on that opportunity. David.
Thanks very much for that introduction. I appreciate it, Richard. I remember trying to get a hold of you when I was doing that story about the Pentagon. I've been thinking a lot lately about Dr. Wen Liang, the ophthalmologist in China, who tried to raise an early alarm in the city of Wuhan about this deadly new plague we all now know as the coronavirus. Instead of being praised for reacting quickly to the emerging facts of this grave threat, he was instead hauled before the police and made to retract his warnings and actually apologize for speaking the truth. And because the Chinese government was intent on spreading nothing to see here lies and feel-good propaganda for several crucial early weeks, we are now facing a global pandemic and a worldwide economic contraction. The current toll is 83,000 infected and nearly 3,000 dead. And among the dead is that brave truth teller, Dr. Wen Liang. To me, and I'm sure to many of you, Dr. Wen Liang is a symbol of something that is becoming blindingly obvious in ever larger swaths of the world. The truth needs reinforcements, urgently, desperately. The idea of truth as the organizing principle of our society is up for grabs. A world built on facts, on measurable realities, on science, a world built on and around truth. That world needs reinforcements. And I'm not simply talking about the lies spewing with increasingly brazen intensity from political leaders across the globe. I'm also talking about the bot armies deployed on Twitter to spread those lies. I'm talking about Facebook saying straight up that it won't lift a finger to stop the spread of lies when they are uttered by political leaders. I'm talking about tens of thousands of truth seekers, otherwise known as journalists, being laid off while the world of spin and strategic communication keeps growing by leaps and bounds. I'm talking about ever more aggressive attempts to demonize and criminalize the act of reporting. I'm talking about rapidly eroding whistleblower protections, rapidly intensifying leak investigations, and rapidly diminished public records laws. I'm talking about news deserts. I'm talking about the willingness of titans like Bernie Madoff and Elizabeth Holmes to make the obliteration of truth a core part of their business models. The truth needs reinforcements. And that, in a nutshell, is why I have devoted my life to investigative reporting. I wanted to do all I possibly could to combat a world organized around lies. I wanted to assert again and again my right to question authority. God invented investigative reporters to scrutinize the dark corners where power is concentrated, where power is abused. I love the dark. And more than that, I cherish how lucky I am to live in a country where me and my fellow lovers of dark corners can still publish hard and unwelcome facts about people in power without fear of being killed or imprisoned or exiled or sued into oblivion. Simply for telling the truth. For years, decades really, I took that right for granted. I just assumed I could do my thing and then come to work the next day and do it again, month after month, year after year. I don't anymore. And that is the most important message that I wanted to deliver today about the state of investigative reporting in our beloved country. We can no longer take for granted our right to do this kind of work. The more political and economic power is organized around perpetuating lies, myths, nonsense, the more power insists that 2 + 2 = 9, the more dangerous it is to tell inconvenient truths and insist that no, 2 + 2 = 4. This basic dynamic has long ruled in places like China and Russia. But the same toxic dynamic is rapidly spreading. Venezuela, Brazil, Hungary, the Philippines, Mexico, Turkey, Egypt, India. My friends and fellow investigative reporters in these places are being hounded and harassed, accused of being enemies of the people, spreading fake news. The truth needs reinforcements. I've been doing this work for a long time. I just began this teaching thing a few months ago. In the course of my 33 years of investigative reporting, I've had a contract taken out on my life. I've been assaulted. I've been threatened at gunpoint. I've had more death threats than I can count. But I can tell you that in the last few years, it has never felt more dangerous to do this kind of work. The venom, the number, the intensity of the threats has increased significantly. It's always an interesting moment for me when people ask me, what do you do for a living? For the longest time, I always felt a certain kind of pride in saying, I'm an investigative reporter. I still feel incredible pride in playing that role. But it feels riskier for me now to actually answer that question to strangers. The truth needs reinforcements. We can no longer take this act of investigative reporting for granted, even in this marvelous place called the United States of America. And with that, let's have a cheerful discussion.
Well, that's all positive and upbeat. I love your words that reflect Reinhold Niebuhr, God invested investigative reporters to examine the dark corners of power. There's a lot there. So, what's the point of all this gotcha journalism, dragging the economy and the country down with all this negativity? If we didn't have all this negative reporting on coronavirus, the stock market would be doing so much better today, right, David?
I mean, that actually is precisely the point, isn't it? We just had three newspapers yesterday, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, and the Washington Post, all broke a story about a whistleblower. A whistleblower who said that the people that the government sent to meet people coming off the plane from China were not prepared to do that job, did not wear the correct clothing, were not trained in how to do that job. And many of those people then got on airplanes and flew home after that. And that whistleblower, according to the whistleblower complaint reported on by all three newspapers yesterday, wasn't thanked, wasn't said, oh, that's great, it's really important, it's good that we know this information so that we can chase these people down and make sure that they're put in isolation or whatever other measures would be sensible. Instead, that person, according to the complaint, has been removed from their job. That is a perfect example of what I just talked about. A world that is increasingly built on nonsense, on propaganda. A world that increasingly is resistant to just the facts.
Shawn, you're an editor of the AJC. You had a big role in that project we just heard about for about an hour. There's a lot of embarrassment for those agencies there. what's the point of doing this kind of gotcha journalism where you embarrass these agencies? Isn't that just negative?
Well, first, I'll start and say we don't do gotcha journalism. If we're going to get you at the AJC, you're going to know what's coming long before it comes. You're going to have every opportunity to tell your side of the story. And we're not out to get to anybody. We try to reveal and dig into how our systems work in Georgia. And if they're not working, or they are not working the way they should work, we believe it's in the public interest, to get that information out so that it can be fixed. If someone is embarrassed by that, maybe they should do their job better. Maybe that's a better solution than trying to suppress the news. It's not about gotcha. You know, people think somehow this is, oh, they're just doing it to sell papers. Trust me, investigative journalism is the most expensive and perhaps least profitable part of our business. If we were just doing it to sell papers, we would cover
sports. But it does differentiate your paper from the people sitting in their pajamas blogging at home.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah. It keeps
this
us in business.
This is a business imperative for you to do that work.
It is, absolutely. But
so
it is not.
Describe that philosophy and how that works.
Okay, well, so at the AJC, we talk to our readers regularly, and our readers say that investigative journalism for them is table stakes. If you're not doing investigative journalism, you're not a major metro newspaper, and they don't believe you have the value that you should have. They believe that is our job. You know, y'all heard Carrie and Lois talking about all the time they spent doing that senior care investigation. If you want to do that, to decide where to put your mom, you know, something's wrong. You really want the press to do that for you. People can't go out and investigate the government on their own. It's very difficult. It's not to say there aren't people who do that, but they're a special breed your average person doesn't do. So our readers and subscribers and people who pay us to do our work, which is important, expect us to do that work.
So I have failed in one of the basic jobs of a moderator, and that is to introduce the panel. So you've been hearing from Shawn McIntosh, who in my view is one of the giants of investigative journalism in the US. As editorial director of the AJC, she oversees all the news content and leads the AJC's investigative and data-driven journalism. And you've already heard about one of her team's projects. She's also been very involved nationally in investigative reporters and editors, and she, like me, carries the title of President Emeritus of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Sitting next to Shawn is Dale Russell. He's been a fixture in Atlanta of the very best kind for more than 30 years. He's a senior investigator reporter at Fox 5, WAGA. He covered the Atlanta child murders, the Olympic Park bombing, which we'll talk more a little bit about later this afternoon, delivered devastating exposés on Georgia House Speaker and then presidential candidate Herman Cain. So two different big projects there. He's just aired expose, if you missed it, was about a secret bank account in rec center at College Park where somebody had an ATM card and was literally pulling $100,000 out of that city bank account in cash. So some really nice work that sparked a GBI investigation. And then Ashley Fantz, I've known since she joined CNN in 2006, one of the news organization's best hires in my view. Dogged investigative journalist, she focuses on crime, military issues, and gender violence. Among her extraordinary projects, The Uncounted, a look at the extraordinary 22 veterans a day who commit suicide, victims of the cumulative trauma of 12 years of war. And Destroyed, a national investigation into how police departments and prosecutors ignored, never processed, then trashed rape kits, letting down thousands of victims of sexual assault, allowing those perpetrators to go free. What's the difference, Dale, between what your colleagues do locally, day in and day out, and what you do. Are you chasing the news every day? Is there pressure on you to turn a story every single newscast?
No. When you say colleagues, do you mean investigative colleagues or just colleagues?
Your journalism colleagues at WAGA.
What we do, I think, is extremely different. In both aspects of this reporting are very important, but ours is very different. And I work, and we were talking a little bit about this earlier, Fox, who some of the older folks in the audience know that at one time we were WAGA, we were store-owned, and we have had, since 1977, uninterrupted, never less than two, as many as nine, investigative team in place at this television station. So it began by Richard Belcher, who's now at WSB.
Who we'll hear from a little later.
Who's here, and Michael Carlin was his original photographer, morphed into his producer, was my executive producer. So we have this amazing history at this television station of doing investigative reporting and being left alone. And so they leave us alone. We're not tied into a daily schedule. I don't even go to the morning meetings. I don't want to go to the morning meetings. I frankly don't even want to be seen by anybody in management while I'm at work.
Are you scared that they would know that you're still employed there?
Some have questioned that. We're in a separate part of the building, and we don't interact with the day-to-day. I mean, they need us at times, and you know, they pick up the phone, and do you know this person, can you do that? But we're very independent, and we're given time to work on a project, and given time, and this is very unusual in my industry. We did a story this week that was 6 minutes long of air tape. And an average TV story is a minute 15 to a minute 30. An average, I would say, investigative story in Atlanta would be 3 minutes. Now, I'm not saying that the bosses weren't raising an eyebrow or two, and there was a lot of last-second editing, but it's an amazing opportunity to me to be given the time to work on it and then time to tell the story. That's the key for investigative reporting. The longer we can work on it, the more thorough it's going to be, the more educated we're going to be about the topic, and I think ultimately the better the story is going to be.
So do you think your bosses think that the investment they're making in you and your investigative colleagues is worth the input, worth the cash?
Yes, I do. And I think I think it ties into that longevity. I think investigative reporting at Channel 5 is so intertwined from a brand point of view, a marketing point of view, that I could never imagine our television station doing away with it. And we're not the only ones in Atlanta. I mean, everybody has an investigative unit at every affiliate in the city now. That is not always the case historically, but everybody is in the game now. And I think most of these, well, obviously, the owners at all these stations feel they have to be, that they have to provide this product, if you will, to compete with the other stations.
When you say
market.
compete in what way?
Draw audience, but also inform the people. It's a dual edge. I mean, obviously, they wouldn't put the money in us if they didn't think that people were going to tune in to watch us. Our job is a little bit different. I'm not that worried about the ratings, but I am worried about informing the public.
Ashley, you've been at CNN since 2006. Mm-hmm. You've turned some really big projects in that time. Ever felt pressure? Listen, you got to get this turned because we need to move you on to Trump. We need to move you on to some other big project.
No, I would say that the last big project that I worked on, where we were able to canvass the entire country and do probably close to 800 records requests and ask
Describe what that was.
So it started in 2015 when I was had to cover a daily story, so I wasn't doing investigative journalism. And there was a police chief in Fayetteville, North Carolina, that very hastily called a press conference and announced that his department had destroyed 333 rape kits. And then he just said, we're really sorry about that, and sort of sheepishly got off stage. And I thought, what the hell? How does that even happen? And so I think every good investigative story begins with a, you know, what the hell kind of question. And I could have just said, well, that's my daily story, I'm done with it. But the next day I filed a records request that after some help with a from a CNN lawyer, we managed to get an audit that someone internally had done that showed all of these rape kits that they destroyed. They had never tested them. They destroyed them sometimes just a couple months after victims reported. There were all sorts of shenanigans going on. Did some reporting there, then took that idea to an editor. And I want to make this point for the students in the audience or for the young journalists in the audience. You will undoubtedly encounter an editor who is too busy, too narrow-minded, or just doesn't have time for you. And that's what happened to me initially. I took this idea about looking and seeing if agencies were destroying rape kits across the country, and that editor said, even after I brought the audit to them, he just was not interested in it. So, okay, so dad says no, I'm gonna go to mom. And so I went to Jan Winburn, actually, who is, some of you might know her, but she is a legendary editor. And she sat with me for 3 hours in her office while we tried to decipher this audit. And that turned into 3 years, 3 years of work. It probably could have been turned a lot sooner, but it was 3 years. And it had incredible results. Because of that story, we have a new law in Georgia prohibiting the destruction of rape kits because it was Representative Holcomb who saw the project and proposed that legislation. A lot of police chiefs publicly apologized. Several law enforcement agencies stopped destroying rape kits. I shed many a tear getting calls from sexual assault survivors. And you talked about gotcha journalism. Of course, none of us do that. But what I was really interested in that project was sitting with cops and understanding why they were trashing this evidence. And it wasn't because they were twirling their mustaches because they're evil and they want to, you know, mess up rape investigations. They were just not properly trained, and they didn't understand trauma. They didn't understand what a rape victim endures. There's all of these problems, and after that project, or in the course of the 3 years we were doing it, a lot of chiefs said, we have to change. Not only are we gonna be embarrassed, that's inevitable, the story is going to embarrass us, but we're gonna change, we're gonna get our people what they need to do better to protect our communities.
Dale, where do you get your story ideas, and how do you convince your bosses to let you run with the story?
The story ideas has changed dramatically over the years. I get a ton of them now through email.
Somebody emails you, hey, yes. Here's a great idea, Dale, go do
yes.
it.
When you're on television locally, you kind of build a relationship with an audience, and they kind of feel like they know you. And so people who I don't know, never known before, not sources, not people who I've worked with and dealt with, will get online and zap out an email, and I'm amazed at how good some of the tips are that have come in that way, just anonymously. And the rest of it is just old shoe leather people that you've known for 20 years that you can turn to and talk to and pick up the phone and call them and say what's going on, and you know they're going to shoot straight with you because you've known them for a long time. What was the second part of that?
How do you convince the editors to do it, to take on the story? Make your pitch to Shawn. She's a big shot editor.
I would listen to, our reporters got us, and I'm sure y'all guys, your bosses. And, so
right,
they're in the trenches. They know what's going on.
We have a Shawn, who's the executive producer of the I-Team, and we have story conference meetings, I guess you would call them. And we all get together in the room, and it's me and there's two other reporters, a couple of producers, photographer comes in, the editor comes in, the boss comes in. So you've got 7 to 8 different opinions and minds, and we pitch the stories. And it's not, it's hard. I mean, they're all journalists, so. Nobody's going to give you an easy take on this, and they ask you tough questions. They ask you, why should anybody care? Why are you doing that? What was this? And did you think of that? And we go through that process, and I don't know what percentage, that would be interesting to know, but a good percentage of them are tossed out at that point. we've all been doing it now for so long that we have a pretty good idea when we get the tip where we're going to be at the end if everything works well. So a lot of those stories come in and make it through the story conference. But if I can't convince a group, that room full of journalists, that this is a worthwhile story, I know I'm going to be in trouble.
David, how did you convince the editors of the New York Times to run with one of yours, and how did that differ from your experience at the other institutions where you worked?
I'll tell you how I frame my entire career. It's around a really simple idea. The simple idea is, I basically put myself in the shoes of my editors, and I imagine what it feels like to them when I come in and I propose a particular story. And I think of my editors as basically they're gamblers, right? They're placing bets on reporters and on stories. And if I had walked into the New York Times on day one in 1999 and had said, you know, if you give me 18 months, I think I can tell you a story about the President of the United States committing serial tax fraud, they would have thrown me out of the office, and properly so, because it would have been such a stupid bet for them to place. And so my whole strategy, my entire career, has been about trying to figure out what's the largest bet I can ask my editor reasonably to place on me, and then making damn sure that I pay that bet off. And then the next time I come back and I ask them to make a slightly larger bet on me. And so in the early days of my investigative reporting career, I actually realized that it would be completely insane to walk up to an editor and say, give me 6 months to do a story, when I was like brand new out of J school and didn't know what the hell I was doing. And so for those who are the journalism students in the room, what I did was I basically decided I had two jobs. I had my day job, which was to feed the beast, and then I had my night and weekend job, was to be secret agent man. And I would basically try to identify something that felt special to me, that felt more, that felt bigger. And I would, without telling my bosses what I was doing, I would go and do all of the work that I needed to do, the reporting work, the reading, all of that, till I got to a point where I felt I had a sure winner, right? And once I knew I had a sure winner, then I would go to my boss and say, listen, if you could just give me 3 days, I think I could produce this amazing piece for the Sunday paper. And they'd be like, oh my God, I can't believe what this guy can do in 3 days. So the next time I ask for a week, and then before you know it, I'm asking for 18 months, right? And that's basically the way I frame my entire career right there, around the concept of gambling.
When you talk about gambling and seeing stuff, how did you find the stories? Where did the ideas come from?
So this is by far the hardest thing in journalism, and I consider story conception to be the single most important thing that I do. Because when I commit to a story, I'm well aware that when I'm committing to that story, I'm also making a commitment not to do a million other stories that are really begging to be attended to as well. And so when I honestly, story conception and how I conceive of stories, yes, obviously, anyone who does this for a while, we get tons of tips, we look at those tips, and some of them you go for. But what I'm really looking for is I'm looking for a set of ingredients before I say yes to a story tip. So the first ingredient always is I want stories that take me directly at concentrated power, those dark corners that I referred to. If a story isn't taking me toward concentrated power, then I'm probably not going to pursue that story. I want stories that no one else is doing. I want stories that are multidimensional. I want stories that say something larger about the world that we live in. I want stories that take you, I especially adore stories that take you inside the plumbing of how the world actually works. This is why I love the rape kit stuff. It was amazing because it took you inside the plumbing of this weird part of bureaucracy that no one ever really thought about, right, very much before. And then you discover, wait, there's a whole thing around this, right? And so those stories that get you closer to how the world really looks, that's one of the things that I'm looking for when I'm assessing stories. But like coming up with great investigative, they do not fall off the tree. It takes an enormous commitment to find great story ideas. It requires a commitment to the thing that you care about, the thing that you're obsessed with. So for
for years, one of the things I was really interested in was the growth of multinational corporations. I just thought this was a really important story, and I was looking for a tip that would take me in the direction of that. And one day I got a tip about Walmart, and how Walmart had basically bribed its way across Mexico and then covered it up. It wasn't much of a tip. I mean, it was like a couple of pieces of paper, but that was the tip. And I jumped on that because I thought, okay, this is really interesting. This could actually take me in this direction that I've been interested, I've been reading about for years. And you know, so like, you know, the commitment that it takes to be super interested in an obscure topic. I'm a total nerd. When I can't sleep at night, I'm always watching C-SPAN. I love reading GAO reports. I love like reading congressional testimony. I read the entire Senate Intelligence Committee report on WMDs just because. And it kind of you have to have that kind of weird sort of mindset, I think, that's constantly searching the world, looking for story ideas, stories that take you into these dark corners that no one else is looking at.
You're so right, though. If you mentioning IG reports, GAO reports, that really is a practical piece of advice if you're looking for a good investigative story. Dig into those reports. I mean, many of them are very interesting. And find, you know, obscure agencies. You know, the whole point of an inspector general is to kind of do your kind of groundwork for you a little bit and discover and show that there's wrongdoing. And I think, yeah, I read those too. I'm so glad to find another person.
They're like, honestly, they're the worst written documents in history of mankind. Okay, but if you read them and if you read them with an eye toward that, you sort of see, oh, wait a minute, there's a path toward something.
Yeah.
So Ashley, your last big project was a monster in terms of records.
Yeah.
How do you organize your evidence, for want of a better word? How do you pull that stuff together in a way that you can find it all? I know the AJC's investigation to the nursing homes is a huge amount of evidence. So let's start with you, Ashley. How do you actually manage that detail?
I think you need to know yourself. So I'm an analog person, so I print everything, which is horrible for organizing. But I know that's not an answer to the question, but find yourself a really good data journalist who can build a database for you, which is what we did with Rape Kids. I do remember the first time that Sergio Hernandez came into my office and couldn't find me because there was paper up to here. And then we began the long process of putting everything into a database. I mean, there are different methods. You can use OneNote, you can use, I don't know, I'm sure you have plenty of methods, but you have to use something that is secure, so make sure that you talk to your lawyers at your news organization. You know, don't put something into Google Doc that you don't want somebody else seeing. Don't put it into, you know, there are various other things that are easily, you could easily get sued over, subpoenaed, that kind of thing, and then you'd lose access to what you really need. So you have to find a way to keep organized. And when you're sending out, you know, 700 records requests. We actually built a tool to do that for us. By we, I mean Sergio, and which is helpful because I just sent out 50 records requests, one to each state yesterday, and was able to do that in a flash. But that still means that I have to pick up the phone and talk to everybody, you know, that has something to say about the records request. So you've got to figure out a system for yourself.
Dale, how do you organize your stuff?
That's an unfair question. I am by birth, by nature, intrinsically disorganized. That's just how I roll. And I'm very much the analog person that you're talking about. It is a constant struggle for me. And it is gotten tremendously worse with where everything comes from. Because I get tips, I get information that are all part of an ongoing story, and some of it's an email, some of it's in Twitter, some of personal messages sent to me on Twitter, some of it's in Facebook, some of it's I've copied out and printed, and I find it to be extremely difficult. do a lot of, I can't do anything until I've done a timeline. I have to have a timeline. I have to be able to read, when did this happen? When did it happen then? I'm really big on, I call them link charts. I'm not sure what the real name of it is to a mathematician, but the little circles with the name on it and how all these people are connected. And I mean, I can fill a board by the time it looks like a mafia investigation up in New York by the time it's all done. I find organization, there's so much information coming in so many different places that I'll find one place where we put all of our video and start dumping all of my documents in there, and the editor comes in and says, I can't find any video. There's so many damn documents in here. So it's just a constant struggle to me with big projects that last a long time to keep it all together and to keep it in a way that you can understand it quickly when you have to go back to it.
Shawn, I know you, Ms. Organization, because I've worked with you in great detail at the First Amendment Foundation. So how do you do it at the AJC?
Well, it is really, it's a function of the reporter. The reporters do it differently. But just so for the big picture, the reason it matters is because these are the highest risk stories that we publish. And so what you're really organizing all this is to make sure that you're all that these facts you're gathering do lead up to the conclusions that you end up putting into your stories. And then so that we can fact check the stories at the end. And fact check the stories at the end, I mean, someone other than the reporter, often several people, many people, we'll make sure that the conclusions are valid and that the facts are valid, and that if we're accusing someone of wrongdoing, we're accusing them with the exact nuance that we should, not just to be legally sound as you can be, but to also be as fair as you can be. So in our newsroom, I don't force the reporters to each use, you know, my style of investigation. But it is a question we ask every time. If we're hiring an investigative reporter, one of the questions we vet deeply is, what is your methodology for gathering information, building it into a case or a conclusion that you're making, and then prosecuting that conclusion to make sure you didn't reach the wrong conclusion?
Does this sound like a lawyer's job? The lawyers, are the lawyers involved extensively at the AJC?
I mean, it depends on how risky the story is, but certainly all high-risk stories have lawyers involved. And we have a fantastic lawyer, Tom Clyde, who's here in the room, who is, you know, as good a journalist as many journalists and also a great lawyer. So, but he's very used to working with different reporters who have an expectation that if he says, how did you reach this conclusion in the 17th paragraph on part four of a five-part series, that they can put their hands on the document, and that's why they have to be organized.
David, how do you organize your stuff?
I mean, first of all, I honestly never felt right or comfortable until after David McCraw, the amazing lawyer for the New York Times, had fly-specked one of my stories. I felt edgy, a little restless. I needed to have gone through it with David because he was not just a great lawyer, but he also thought journalistically. And in our world, lawyers basically fall into two categories. There are red light lawyers and green light lawyers. And I like green light lawyers, and David's a green light lawyer, and he was absolutely, has always been, for me, an essential part of my work. Organization, my tombstone will read, chronology was his friend. I find that the act of organization is absolutely critical to the work that I do. And it's critical for a bunch of reasons. One is, one of the things that's difficult about doing investigative reporting is you carry the weight of all of the facts that you gather. Every fact that you gathered
it has a kind of specific gravity to it. And the more of these facts you sweep up, you literally can feel the burden of that on your back. I'm sure you guys have experienced this. Being really organized with your material is a way of managing the psychological burden of carrying that weight, number one. Number two, the act of organizing, the act of taking the time to write up your notes, to go through all of your documents, and I'm analog, or I guess we're all analog up here. There are all kinds of fancy programs you can use to search electronically big bunches of documents. I don't. I read them all. I print them out and I read them all. But the act of doing that and then of organizing as you're doing that and doing chronologies as you're doing that and making yourself write up your interview notes that night, not waiting, doing it right away, the act of doing all that is the act of marinating yourself in the factual record that you must master in order to tell this story. So if I see an investigative reporter who's just stacked under mounds and mounds of disorganized documents, to me that's a huge red flag. That would be a problem if I were an editor. I actually think that the act of organizing, the act of processing, is absolutely integral to the act of ultimately being able to produce really great investigative narratives. And one final point, which is one of the most difficult moments in any investigative project is the moment when you transition from reporting to storytelling, from reporting to writing. And if you haven't organized well along the way, that is where you see reporters hitting that ugly thing called writer's block. There's just this massive amount of material and they haven't organized it, and it's all sort of sitting there and they just know a million different facts, and it's like, where do I begin? Where do I start my story? And I think that there's a direct relationship between writer's block, which is definitely a thing for investigative reporters, and organizing. So those are all.
I would add that's the biggest challenge for young investigative reporters, that they think they're going to gather everything up and then decide what it means and how to write it. And I mean, I don't have an analogy for a lawyer, but I think it'd be sort of like 2 days before you go to court figuring out what case you're going to present. Doesn't right. work very well.
So let's talk a little bit about trust in journalism, which is, according to the latest Edelman survey worldwide, we're lagging way behind everybody except government. So government is in a worse place than journalists, but journalists are really in a tough place. How do you build trust-enhancing components into the investigative journalism? Because otherwise, in theory, it's, you know, politicians have an easy shot. Well, it's the stinky New York Times, it's the liberal AJC, it's the funky wagger, that liberal CNN. It's very easy to dismiss. How do you build the components in that allow the audience to trust what you're writing? Ashley?
I was just thinking about building trust with the people that you're interviewing.
I'm thinking more about the public.
About the public? Well, I mean, I really wish that CNN would get an ombudsman or ombudswoman and explain what we have at CNN, which is a very rigorous fact-checking. We have something called the triad, which sounds really Darth Vader-y, but it's just a group of sort of gatekeeping editors with our standards and practices, and then the third part of that are our attorneys. And you know, whenever someone, I mean, you know, I've been spat at, and everyone here is, I'm sure, you know, especially, I don't really tell people that I work for CNN anymore, which is really kind of a tragedy, but I just don't want to deal with it. And so I just expect negativity coming at me just because of that. But, I think what I've done is said, well, you know what, come into CNN and I'll show you exactly how it works. I think we can do a better job. I mean, in terms of the people that are part of my stories, I always do quote readbacks and context checks with people. And it doesn't matter whether I'm accusing them of wrongdoing or, you know, they're a source of mine who's not being accused of anything wrong. I just let them know up front that I'm going to do that, and that that they're not going to be surprised, and that is not an opportunity to change a quote. But it is a chance to say, you know what, let me let me say more to you about this topic. And oftentimes I get even further in an interview that way.
At the AGC, what steps are you taking to build trust related to your investigative reporting?
Well, I would say two things, that, and it relates in general to all the journalism, but certainly you go further and work harder at it when you're accusing someone of something of wrongdoing. But I think, you know, super high standards of fairness. So, you know, Ashley said no surprises. We're not going to put something in the paper bad about you that you don't know is coming, have not had multiple opportunities to talk through. You know, I'm just going to tell you this secret. If you're ever being investigated by the AJC, if you don't want to talk for the record, you still ought to have a conversation, because we'll have a conversation that says we're going to tell you everything we're going to say about you. And you're going to have a chance to say, no, that's wrong, and you can't quote me, but here's a document that proves you're wrong. Or here's a friend who will speak for me, who will tell you. So we give people multiple opportunities to respond to us. And if we can't reach them, then, you know, we go to their home. We knock on their door. People say, oh, you're hounding them. We're not hounding them. We're trying to be impeccably fair. And then the other thing is just tremendous transparency. We need to share, and we, you know, we can only get better at this. It's not been a tradition in journalism until probably 10 years ago, and we're working on it every day, getting better. But explaining to people what it is we do and how it is we work and what it is that we're trying to do to get it right, to make sure we have the facts. Sharing our documents online, sharing our, you know, that we tried to attempted to talk to someone multiple times, sharing that, you know, someone challenges us and that we reviewed for a correction and we determined there was no correction warranted for these reasons. Journalism used to be a bit of a black box, and it can't be if we're going to build trust. That said, as readers, I want to tell you that you have an obligation to read carefully for that kind of transparency. And I'm not going to name names, but I'll give a recent investigation where we did an investigation of a politician who, for multiple opportunities to talk to us, never did, never spoke to us, never corrected or said anything was wrong, asked for other spokespeople that could represent this person, didn't get that. And then after the story came out, the press release went out saying we were fake news. And it was wrong. And it didn't say what was wrong. It just said fake news and wrong. And so as readers, you need to challenge that too. When you hear that, you need to know that if people are saying something's wrong, push and say what, right?
Have any of you partnered with outside not-for-profits who do investigative work, ProPublica, Center for Investigative Reporting, or others?
Yeah, we've
worked. How is that process work?
Well, it's different for everyone, but...
Do you pay them money for their work?
Not typically, no. Usually you're working together to produce a journalistic product that will appear in their publication and your publication. And it can be really challenging, especially for us, because we're so locally oriented, and so if we work with a national organization, we found sometimes it's just painfully difficult because you know, they might have different goals and be willing to go by, I don't mean different journalistic standards, but just different values. You know, we worked with ProPublica on a story, and their story ended up having a lot about Kentucky in it, and we weren't that interested in Kentucky, and so there's that. And then the other thing that I'll just be honest about is that the online organizations tend to go a lot longer than the newspaper can. They'll write a whole lot of words, and we have to get it down to a reasonable length.
I had very similar experience at CNN. We had a partnership with an organization on the West Coast that was, we were doing a big project on mental health, and the TV pieces were very tightly focused on particular cases, along with the survey data and the records that the organization had brought. They wanted to also do 30 other examples for each of the other markets, but the entire project was co-branded with CNN, and that meant that the lawyers and the editorial vetting team and the standards and practices people had to vet not only the work we were doing and we were running, but also all of these other 30 pieces that were going to run. Literally, I ended up with a legal team spending an entire weekend working through those issues. It was a great project. We won all kinds of awards. Was it worth doing? Yes. But it was, it put a chilling effect on those kind of partnerships. Last question to the panel, and we'll open up for questions. Just very briefly, what are the best characteristics of personality traits for being a successful investigative reporter? David?
Abnormal curiosity and relentless persistence. That's really all you need.
Ashley?
A bit of fearlessness, no matter how powerful someone is that you're challenging, it doesn't stop you.
I would totally agree with the first two. I would add an absolute, innate, strong sense of fairness.
And I would add to that a strong sense of fairness for the people that you're covering and writing about, and a strong sense of justice that I'm sorry, I know we get accused of being a liberal media, and I guess when you think government ought to work, that tilts you toward the liberal side because it tilts you in favor of government. But a sense that justice, that the government ought to work and that it ought to serve people, and that if you're going to write about something that's broken, it is to bring about justice.
We have 10 minutes. So I think we have time for one last question from me for the panel, then we'll open it up. David, briefly, tell us an investigative moment that you screwed up and what you would do differently.
I remember when I worked at the Rochester Times in upstate New York, and I thought I was kind of a hotshot reporter, and I especially thought that, man, I had really wired the police department incredibly well. And the police chief and I would talk constantly. Chief would call me up at night, call me up in the morning. I was way ahead of everybody, and I just thought, man, I'm just the badass investigative reporter here. Sometime after, that police chief was arrested. And it turned out that all of those nights and mornings when he was calling and whispering sweet nothings to me about the latest drug bust, he was actually stealing hundreds of thousands of dollars of federal drug buy money. And it had all happened right under my nose. And in part, it had happened because I had been seduced into thinking that I actually had some relationship with this police chief. And one of the great lessons I took from that is when public officials are too eager to talk, that's usually a bad sign.
Ashley.
When I was working on The Uncounted, which was about military family members committing suicide in the Pentagon, not counting those suicides, the main person in that story was a spouse of a Marine who had attempted suicide several times, and I felt at one point, without going into it too much, I felt at one point that her children were in danger, that she was very, very unstable. And she turned to me, and I remember actually being in your office, being very worried about this all of a sudden, but that she, it was really difficult, and I didn't know, you know, there was a question as to, okay, I'm just gonna drop the story and maybe get social services involved. Is she going to hurt her children, that kind of thing. And she called me that afternoon and said, but you know, I've told you so many intimate things about myself. I've told you so many things, you know, I trusted you, you're a friend. And I just thought, no, I have to be very clear with her. I had said this to her several times before too, in the most empathetic and loving way you can possibly say it, that I am not your friend, that I'm a journalist, and I am going to show as much care as I can to the truth of your story, but you cannot see me as a friend. And so I think that that's really kind of what you have to do, and it's very hard because these stories can get super emotional, but you have to be very clear about that.
Dale?
I'm going to tell a story that's never been told outside our walls, to the best of my knowledge, but years ago, and I learned a valuable lesson. We were doing this. The tip was that a local city contractor had given luxury SUVs to city officials, ostensibly to get the contract. We pulled the contract. There was no cars to be provided to the city officials overseeing the contract. We spent, speaking of gambling, David, I think if I recall, 6 months doing surveillance of the city officials driving around in the luxury SUVs. I know it was several months. It was because the seasons changed during it, and it was hard to find them, which is why it took so long. We got it all together. We had the video. The video was in my bag. We went in for the final interview, and as we began the interview, I was ready to pull the bag out and show the video to the guys, and there was a bunch of their folks over there, and they had no idea why we were there. And at some point, before I pulled it out, thank the dear Lord, somehow the cars came up, and a guy pulled back and looked at me and went, wait a second, is this all about the SUVs that we've got? Is that why you're here? And I think at that point I said, yeah, and I said, well, it's not in the contract. And the guy next to him said, it's not in his contract, but it's in my contract. There was a subcontractor contract. We had read the contract, David. We didn't ask for the subcontractor's contracts. And we wasted 6 months, a lot of time, a lot of energy, I guess a lot of the company's money, because I didn't get all of the contracts. I now get all of the contracts when I go in and ask.
Sure.
And I never pulled out the video.
We spent several months on a national story about a company, malfeasance at a company, and it was not a seasoned investigative reporter working for a not seasoned investigative editor. And as we got closer to the end of the story, I found out that the investigative reporter had been working with an employee at the company and had shared our internal documents with them, had let them shape the story, had a great deal of inappropriate relationship and behavior, and I had to yank the story and discipline the reporter and not let them do investigative reporting at work again, pretty much.
So, let's open it up for a couple of questions. David is going to have the microphone. Any questions from the audience? I have one right behind you, David.
Hi. I have two-part questions. One is there a nonprofit version of Courtroom View Network (CVN) that does public interest courtroom recordings and puts it on, makes it available publicly at no charge for everybody, including investigative journalists and everybody else? A related thing is there a version of...
To my knowledge, no.
I'm sorry?
To my knowledge, no.
Other than... You can go to CourtLink. I'm not sure that I understand, but CourtLink and... There's various ways to get court documents. I think
right,
that's what you're
but they all
right.
cost money, yeah. And for people without means, it's not a good option. So there should be a public option, I think, so to speak. The other related question is there somebody or some organization that does long-form investigative journalism in rural Georgia, especially as it relates to First Amendment issues, that is, some version of ProPublica or Vox that does this sort of thing in rural Georgia?
My first thought to that is if it's rural Georgia, it may still have a connection to a city like Atlanta. If the story is big enough, the topic is big enough, even though it's rural Georgia, you may find folks here that would be interested in going down. We've done stories all over the state if they resonate here in the capital.
David Armstrong, you're running Investigative Project for Students within GPB. Does that cover rural Georgia and some of the work you're doing?
Our stories, we partner with the AJC and GPB and WSB, and we do stories that cover much of Georgia. We've done stories. Many of them have sort of a core to them, but then the story extends out where we see elements of it replayed in many places. We're looking at, right now, at voting issues across Georgia. We did one on tax commissioner fees across Georgia. So it's a matter of looking at the issue and seeing how it plays out in many communities. Seldom do we look at something where it's just located in one place.
Ken Foskin, I know, had a question.
This is really
interesting.
This is
scary when you have the investigative reporter asking questions of the investigative panel. This better not be a softball.
No, it's not. So I wanted to invite David to answer the question that he raised in his remarks, which is about the reinforcements and where are they going to come from and how do we get them there?
Well, first of all, they should start by coming from this room, right? Everyone in this room has a stake in this, and that's point number one. Point number two is the reason why I left the New York Times in August and went to Berkeley was actually to go recruit reinforcements. I am trying to do my damnedest to cajole, sucker as many smart young people as I possibly can into the life of investigative reporting. Because I feel like it's this critical thing. I remember, you know, for the longest time, we all get used to this sort of basic sales pitch about journalism, which is like, good journalism is very important to a functioning democracy, right? Informed citizenry is at the heart of this system. And I, of course, believe all of that. But I actually think that the moment that we're in is far starker than that. And that's why I frame my remarks around a contest between a world organized around lies versus a world organized around truth. And I think that's really what is at stake in this moment. And this is not a political thing, because this covers the whole globe, and it's not even a left-right thing. There's nonsense coming from all sides. And the question is, how do we organize ourselves to fight like hell to preserve a world organized around truth? And the great news is that, to me, the things that fill me with optimism are, one, the absolute brilliance and courage of the students who I am now meeting at Berkeley, who know the score. They know that journalism is a horrible profession to go into right now. There's no jobs, there's no money, and yet they're like, please, let me find a way to get in, because they see the stakes. That's number one. Number two is, you know, I mentioned how sometimes it's a kind of a weird moment when someone asks you what you do, and you say, I'm an investigative reporter. Well, sometimes when you say I'm an investigative reporter, another thing happens and has happened in a way that I've never experienced before in my life, which is sometimes people will literally put their hands on you and say, thank you, right? There's a different response. It's not just the look of like, oh, you're scum. There's another version of that, which is like, oh my God, thank God that you still exist. And I can feel that and see that. And I also, the third thing that fills me with optimism is we can see now how people consume the investigative work that we do. And what I see over and over and over again is that when we produce great investigative stories, the audiences flock to those stories. There is a hunger. There is a deep hunger and passion in this country for journalism that means something. And if you look at the investigative reporting that has bubbled up, I'm not talking about from Washington, I'm talking about from cities and towns all around this country, holding powerful local institutions to account. This is something that we should all be fighting like crazy to preserve.
And on that note, given the timing here, we'll let David's summation bookend his opening. So thank you all so very much. So students, don't forget an opportunity to meet with David. It's going to be in a room, the chairman's boardroom,
President's
down
room.
The
President's.
Hall to the right.
President's
room. President's room.
Follow this way.
That's where details.